जय हिंद। माय नेम इज़ कैडेट मनीष एन भट्ट फ्रॉम फ्लाइट ए 6 कर्नाटका एयर स्क्वाड्रन एनसीसी मैंगलोर ग्रुप कर्नाटका एंड गोवा डायरेक्टरेट। इन दिस प्रेजेंटेशन द टॉपिक विच वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट इज एयरक्राफ्ट इंस्ट्रूमेंटेशन। नाउ देर आर टू पार्ट्स दिस चैप्टर। द फर्स्ट पार्ट इज फ्लाइट इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स, द सेकेंड पार्ट इज रेडार, एंड बोथ पार्ट्स विल बी कवर्ड इन दिस प्रेजेंटेशन। एंड बोथ पार्ट्स आर इंपॉर्टेंट एंड वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग। The first part of this chapter is about the only six-pack a pilot will ever need. In other words, flight instruments. So first things first, what are flight instruments? So all the instruments in the cockpit which provide the pilot with very useful information, such as altitude, airspeed, vertical speed, so on and so forth, are called flight instruments. These instruments, they provide the pilot with the data which he or she needs to pilot the aircraft safely and efficiently and to reach the destination or to complete the objective. So here are four examples of four cockpits of four very different aircraft. The first is a Boeing 747, which is a passenger aircraft. The next is an F-35, which is a fighter jet. The next is a Spitfire, which is a fighter aircraft from World War II. And the last one is Pipistrel Virus, which is a trainer microlight aircraft, which also is used by NCC. So superficially, when you look at take a first glance, these four cockpits look very, very different. And the panels shown in these four images look very different. But all four aircraft have flight instruments because it is extremely essential towards an aircraft regardless of its purpose or function. It may look different, it may appear different, it may have different shapes or sizes, but some flight instruments are present in all aircraft regardless of the purpose or the age. It may be an 80-year-old aircraft or an aircraft from the present day, all of them will have aircraft instruments. So why are flight instruments needed? In our day-to-day life, we just use our five senses to navigate our world around. So we only have to travel in two dimensions, that is front and back or left and right. For that, our senses are adequate. They do the job. You don't need any more help. But flying can be a tricky affair because you are moving in three dimensions, that is up, down, front, back, as well as to the sides. And any combination of these three dimensions, which means that our five senses may not be sufficient to fly an aircraft. In order to make things easier for the pilot, these aircraft instruments are present. They provide the pilot with the information which he or she may not be able to acquire with their own senses. And these instruments are extremely crucial, especially if you're flying in risky weather. Let's say there are poor visibility, or there is poor weather, that is rain or snow, so on and so forth. These instruments help especially during such situations. So before I move on to the different types of flight instruments, I want to talk about the concept of atmospheric pressure, because this is something which is applied in a lot of different instruments which you will see in the coming slides. So what is atmospheric pressure? The atmosphere is made of air, and air has gas molecules. These gas molecules have a certain weight to them, a certain mass to them. And any object which has weight exerts pressure on the area which is underneath the object. For example, if you place a book on the table, the book will exert pressure on the table in the area just underneath the book. Similarly, a column of air which has gas molecules in it will exert a certain pressure on the area which it rests upon. And this pressure is called atmospheric pressure. It's also called barometric pressure because it's measured using a barometer. It can be expressed in various units. It can be expressed in millimeters of mercury or pounds per square inch. And in case of aircraft, it's often shown as millibars. And at sea level, we have come to standard pressure, that is 1013.25 millibars at sea level. We have considered that as a standard pressure at mean sea level. Now this number is very important, so please keep it in mind. The first aircraft instrument is the airspeed indicator. Now just as our cars or bikes have a speedometer to tell us how fast we are going, similarly aircraft will have airspeed indicator, which tells the pilot how fast the aircraft is traveling through the air. And it is just as important as a speedometer in your land vehicles, because information like the speed can be used to make many different calculations which have a wide range of applications in flight. So how does an airspeed indicator work? So it works on the principle of three different pressures. That is dynamic pressure, static pressure and Pitot pressure. Dynamic pressure is the pressure exerted by the air on an object moving through it. So for example, if you take an umbrella and swing it through the air, you will notice that the air has exerted a pressure on the umbrella against the direction of motion. That is called dynamic pressure. The next is static pressure. Static pressure is just the atmospheric pressure at a certain point. So the pressure exerted on an object by the atmosphere around it and above it. The last pressure is Pitot pressure, which is a sum of dynamic pressure and static pressure. And here is on screen is a formula for Pitot pressure in terms of dynamic and static pressures. So from this formula we can understand that if you know two of the quantities, two of the terms in the formula, you can calculate the third one. It is simple math. Just by moving terms around, you can calculate the missing term. And on this principle, the airspeed indicator works. So how does it look mechanically? So mechanically, the airspeed indicator uses something called a Pitot tube and as well as a static tube. Both tubes are connected to a chamber with a diaphragm going through it. The Pitot tube is open to the atmosphere and it is open to the airstream, meaning the airstream can exert a pressure into the Pitot tube. The air passes into the Pitot tube and exerts a pressure through it. Whereas the static tube is closed off to the airstream, meaning the airstream exerts no pressure on it, but it has a few holes in it. And through these few holes, the static pressure can apply on it, or the atmospheric pressure can apply on it. So now the diaphragm has two pressures, one from the Pitot tube, one from the static tube. So together these can be calculated, and by rearranging the formula, once you know the Pitot pressure and the static pressure, you can find the dynamic pressure. And this dynamic pressure is displayed to the pilot. So here on screen I have the images of Pitot tube in three aircraft. The first is a Cessna aircraft, which looks, you have a similar looking Pitot tube even in your virus. It's present underneath the wing and it has an L shape. The next is on a civilian passenger aircraft. It is usually near the cockpit or on the side of the aircraft with a similar L shape. Whereas in fighter aircraft, it will be present at the nose of the aircraft in a same conical or cubular shape. So as you can see on screen, the pressure exerted on the diaphragm may cause it to move in different directions. And the movement of this diaphragm is transmitted to the dial of the airspeed indicator through a mechanical linkage, that is through levers or through springs. And this dial is visible to the pilot and the pilot can see the airspeed. The next aircraft instrument which we'll be talking about is the altimeter. So the altimeter basically shows the pilot their altitude over a certain point, that is over a fixed datum. Datum is singular for data. And it uses the principles of difference in pressure, because as I had mentioned earlier, the atmospheric pressure at mean sea level is known. It is considered the standard. But as you progressively go higher from the mean sea level, the atmospheric pressure decreases, because the column of air above your head decreases as you get closer and closer to space. Moreover, the density of air decreases as you go higher, meaning there are less air molecules or less gas molecules in the atmosphere to exert pressure anyway. So the pressure, air pressure as you go higher decreases, and this correlation can be used to estimate the altitude of an aircraft. And it uses an aneroid barometer to display this as height rather than pressure. This change in pressure is displayed as height. And this aneroid barometer in the altimeter is calibrated to set data, that is in this case mean sea level in usual cases. So how does it work? How does the altimeter work? As I said earlier, the aneroid barometer is calibrated to a set level, meaning the zero is set at the pressure at a certain altitude. This is usually the mean sea level. And in the shape and structure, it consists of a sealed, a partially evacuated capsule with a spring in it for support. So as the aircraft climbs and as the atmospheric pressure decreases, the pressure in the capsule also decreases. And because of this decrease in pressure, the springs are pulled closer. This causes the capsule to move. And this movement in the capsule is translated by gears and linkages to a pointer on a scale or on the dial of the altimeter, which is visible to the pilot. So as per ICAO standards, that is International Civil Aviation Standards, 1013.2 or 1013.25 millibar is considered the mean sea level, the pressure at mean sea level, and this is considered the standard pressure. So the pressure on an altimeter of all aircraft is typically set to this level, and from here the pressure is considered. This is the pressure is considered relative to this number. The next instrument which we will be talking about is the artificial horizon. The artificial horizon is an instrument which displays the altitude of the aircraft in relation to the horizon. And through this, the pilot can estimate if the aircraft is rolling or pitching. That is, he can tell if the wings are level and the nose is pitching up or pitching down. And this is very useful in case the pilot can't see the actual horizon and visually confirm if the aircraft is rolling or pitching. So how does it work? The artificial horizon has a gyroscope. A gyroscope is a device which has a frame, a gimbal and a spin axis. A rotor rotates along the spin axis in such a manner that the spin axis remains fixed to a particular axis. This is due to the conservation of angular momentum. Now such a device is present in the artificial horizon. And this device is fixed to the vertical axis in relation to the center of the earth. Meaning, in case the aircraft rolls and pitches, the vertical axis of the gyroscope remains still, and hence the pilot can understand if the aircraft is rolling or pitching, because as the frame moves, the pilot can see through a dial the roll and pitch. Now in older devices, in older artificial horizon instruments, the aircraft was represented by a fixed symbol and the horizon by a bar stabilized parallel to the earth surface, whereas in more modern displays, the horizon bar is replaced by a ball with a horizon line marked on it, and graduated pitch markings are also present. The bank angle, that is the angle at which the aircraft is rolling, is present at the bottom of the display. This is how a modern artificial horizon may look, but there is some distinction between the Western style as well as the Russian style. The bank angle between these two devices are the same, but the movement of the horizontal bar is displayed differently. In the Western system, the horizon bar remains fixed horizontally, whereas in the Russian system, the horizon appears from the perspective of the pilot in the aircraft. It moves along with the aircraft, but it does the same job, that is, it shows the angle of banking. And in both cases, the angle of banking is going to be the same. The next instrument which we will be talking about is a vertical speed indicator. Now this is somewhat similar to the altimeter in that it relies on pressure again. The vertical speed indicator shows the rate of ascent or descent. That is, it shows the rate of change of altitude of an aircraft. So on what principle does it work? So in case of the vertical speed indicator, there are two chambers. That is, a case and a capsule. So atmospheric pressure is fed into the capsule. In the capsule, the pressure can change freely. But in the case, the pressure is controlled. It is gradually released or gradually applied. So when the pressure outside changes or the pressure outside drops, the pressure in the capsule drops before the pressure in the chamber. And this goes the other way around also. When the pressure outside increases, the pressure in the capsule drops or increases before the pressure in the chamber. And this difference of pressure between the pressure in the capsule and in the case is displayed to the pilot by a pointer. In the case of level flight, there is no difference in pressure since there is no ascent or descent. Hence, the pointer remains at zero. But when ascending, as the pressure decreases, the capsule shrinks before the case. Whereas when descending, as the pressure increases, the capsule expands before the case. And this difference in the or this lag is displayed to the pilot through a pointer, and this pointer is connected to the chamber via linkages. The next instrument we will be talking about is a turn and slip indicator. This is actually two instruments which are displayed together because information is related to each other. The first part is a turn indicator. The turn indicator is similar to the artificial horizon. It uses a gyroscope, but in this case, the gyroscope has freedom of motion only in the roll axis, and it relies on the principle of gyroscopic precession. So basically, whenever a gyroscope experiences external torque, it has a tendency to rotate in a conical shape, as shown here. As you can see, when it releases it, the gyroscope tends to spin in a conical manner. This phenomenon is called gyroscopic precession. When the plane yaws, the precession forces acting on the gyroscope cause it to tilt left or right, and this tilting is displayed to the pilot through a pointer on a needle. The next part is a slip indicator. The slip indicator is more simpler because it relies only on the forces of gravitation and centrifugal force, which is acting on a ball present on a curved tube. And this curved tube is also filled with a certain fluid. So in case of the balanced flight, both forces are acting equally on the ball. So the ball remains at the center of the tube. But if the aircraft is in unbalanced turn, or if it's moving straight but is unbalanced, the ball has a tendency to move all the way to the extreme end of one tube. This is because the gravitational force on the ball has the greater influence than the centrifugal force. Whereas in a balanced turn, the centrifugal force and the gravitational force balance each other out. Because of this, the ball remains at the center of the tube. Now, generally, we consider that if the rate of turn, that is the turn indicator pointer, and if the ball and the slip indicator are displaced in the same direction, the aircraft is considered to be slipping inwards. Whereas if they are displaced in opposite directions, the aircraft is considered to be skidding outwards. Now, in case there is a movement in the turn indicator, but the slip indicator remains at zero position, that is, the ball remains at the middle of the tube, the aircraft is considered to be in a balanced turn. Now, that is what you can see in this representation. In the first image, that is of a coordinated or a balanced turn, you can see that the turn indicator has moved to the right, but the slip indicator, the ball or slip indicator, has remained at the center of the tube. Whereas in slipping turn, the turn indicator is moved to the right, but the ball has also moved to the right. In case of a skidding turn, the turn indicator is moved to the right, but the ball has moved to the left. So through this representation, the pilot can understand how to make a balanced turn or how to fly in a balanced manner. I also want to talk about two structures, that is slats and the next air brakes. So slats are structures present on the wings of the aircraft which are used during the landing, because in some cases during landing there may be low speed or there may be very high angle of attack on the aircraft. In such a case, the aircraft has a risk of stalling, but slats improve the low speed characteristics of an aircraft and it allows the aircraft to land safely during landing. The next is air brakes. So in old aircraft, they had propellers, and when the throttle wasn't applied, the propeller would generate a drag of its own, and this drag would help the aircraft land safely and stop. But in modern aircraft, this propeller isn't there. So as a replacement for this, air brakes provide the drag needed to slow the aircraft down. So air brakes are structured on the airframe of an aircraft and they are extended upon landing or whenever the aircraft has to slow down. And when the air brakes are extended, they increase the drag of the aircraft and this drag slows the aircraft down to come to a stop. Now this is especially essential in modern jet aircraft, because they travel at very high speed and they may have to land also at a higher speed and come to a stop. Hence, air brakes are used. So that is the end of the first part of this chapter, that is the end of flight instruments. Let us move on to the next part, that is radar. What is radar? So radar is actually an acronym and it stands for radio detection and ranging. So it uses radio waves or electromagnetic waves of a specific frequency to detect and estimate the distance or to range an object. And in the modern world, radar sees application in a wide range of fields. It may be used in civilian situations, a civilian aircraft, on scientific reasons, as well as in military roles, where it has a very, very wide application. So how did radar come to be? So the discovery of this sort of occurrence, this phenomenon, started in the early 20th century when scientists realized that electromagnetic waves can hit objects and come back. And they realized that there is a very strong application for this phenomenon. And as the time went on, especially approaching World War II and during World War II, this application translated into modern radar systems because it went through very rapid development. In fact, the term radar itself was coined by the US Navy in 1940, that is in the start of World War II. And this development is often considered the birth of modern radar systems because for the first time in World War II, radar systems were mounted on aircraft. So as you can see on the nose of this aircraft, those are the antenna of the radar system. So how does radar work in the first place? Before touching upon radar, I want to talk a little bit about sonar, which uses sound in place of radio waves. This is seen in bats and in whales or in dolphins, where they generate a sound wave through their vocal systems, through their vocal structures. And this sound wave emanates into the atmosphere around them and into the sea around them and hits any object in the nearby area. It may be a prey object, it may be another fish, it may be a tree, it may be a rock, anything. And when it hits this object, it bounces back to the bat or to the whale. And through this information, the bat and whale can get an estimate of its surroundings. It can understand what is around it or in front of it. A similar system is used in modern day ships and in submarines because sound travels very well through a liquid medium, in this case water. They use a similar system for navigation as well as ranging. That is what sonar stands for: sound, navigation and ranging. But what about aircraft? Aircraft travel through the air, and in the air sound is not as efficient as in water. It cannot be used as easily. Instead of sound, we use electromagnetic waves, specifically radio waves. Hence it is called radio detection and ranging. In every other case, the principle is very similar to sonar. Similarly, the radio waves is emanated into the atmosphere. It may hit an object and return back to the person who has released the radio wave. And on this principle, radar works. So what are the parts of a radar system? There are three fundamental parts. The first is a transmitter, the next an antenna, and lastly a receiver. A transmitter generates radio waves, and these generated radio waves are directed by the antenna. And when these radio waves hit an object and are returned, a receiver receives these radio waves and measures them. It may display this to a viewer in the form of a graph. There are some different types of radar. The first is primary radar. In case of primary radar, a pulse of radio waves is released, a single pulse, and all objects in the path of this wave will reflect back some of the waves which has hit it. So as you can see, the cooperation of this object is not needed. Regardless if the object cooperates or not, the waves will hit it, it will bounce back, and it will be received by the receiver. And this time delay between the transmission and the reception can be used to determine the distance to that particular aircraft. As you can see in this animation, the transmitter and the antenna releases a radio wave, and that radio wave travels through this aircraft. When it hits the aircraft, a certain amount of the waves are bounced back, and the receiver can pick up these waves. And as shown on screen, when the waves are picked up, it shows a spike on the graph. Now there is a certain time delay between the release of the radio waves and the reception of these radio waves, and this time delay can be used to estimate the distance from the antenna or from the transmitter to the aircraft. The next is a secondary radar. In case of secondary radar, a transmitter releases a pulse of radio waves, and a flying object will receive these radio waves and process it. So when these pulses are identified by the flying object, a reply will be given to the transmitter, to the original transmitter. So as you can see, the cooperation of the aircraft is needed for a return to be sent. So such systems are seen in, they have a special use in military application, that is in identification of friend or foe, or IFF systems, which are present on all military aircraft as well as some other military vehicles. The next is continuous wave radar. So in case of the continuous wave radar, the radar emitter emits radio waves continuously at all times. So because of this, there is no real time delay, or there is no way of measuring the time delay. So the radar, in case of a continuous wave radar, the range to the object cannot be measured. However, it can measure the instantaneous rate of change of the aircraft, of the object. So it can estimate the velocity or the speed of the object. And such systems are seen in speed detectors used by police when they want to estimate the speed of a car. This works on the principle of the Doppler effect. Basically, the closer you are to a moving source of sound, the frequency of the waves, sound waves hitting you are high, and the wavelength is low. This works similarly to any electromagnetic wave, where a closer object to a source will receive a higher frequency and lower wavelength of electromagnetic waves, whereas an object placed farther away from a source will receive electromagnetic waves at a longer wavelength but at a lower frequency. And now if this source is moving, the change in the frequency or the change in the wavelength can be used to estimate the velocity of the motion of the object. Now all three systems together can be used in military applications. They usually are used in military applications. And in modern radar systems, they can identify aircraft, they can identify the size of the aircraft, they can identify the velocity and the direction of the motion of the aircraft. This is why radar systems have such an essential role in modern military systems, modern military situations. I also want to make an addition of two terms which you may hear if you're looking up or if you're researching anything about military radar systems or military aircraft. That is PESA and AESA. PESA stands for Passive Electronic Scanning Array, and AESA stands for Active Electronic Scanning Array. See, there is a common term that is scanning array. Basically, there is an array of radar that are there are small transmitters and antennae which are connected together to form an array, and together this works to act like one big radar system. In case of PESA, all the transmitters and all the antennae are connected to one specific transmitter. So there is a single transmitter and many receivers. So a PESA radar can only release a single beam of radio waves at a single frequency at a specific time. Whereas in an AESA system, each antenna is connected to something called a transmit receive module, or a TRM. And an AESA system will have several such TRMs. So because of this, the AESA radar can radiate multiple beams of radio waves of different frequencies simultaneously. So AESA systems are considered more advanced than PESA. But there is an advantage to the PESA system too, in that the PESA system can't be detected as easily as an AESA system. So here is the pictures of two systems. That is a MiG-31 aircraft with a PESA and a Saab Gripen with an AESA radar. As you can see in the nose of the aircraft, there is a circular dish with many different segments in it, many small segments in it, and each segment has a radar element in it. With that, we come to the end of this chapter. Before finishing up, I would like to summarize all what we have learned today. The first topic we learned was aircraft instruments. What are flight instruments? They are all the instruments present in the cockpit in front of the pilot, which provide the pilot with the information such as the altitude or the airspeed. Basically, all information about the flight situation of the aircraft. Why is it needed? So a pilot needs these instruments in order to control an aircraft in all conditions, be it normal conditions or adverse conditions, that is in poor visibility or poor weather. The first instrument we spoke about was the airspeed indicator. The airspeed indicator displays the speed of an aircraft moving through air. It is based on the principle of static pressure, pitot pressure, and dynamic pressure. Using these three terms, we can calculate the airspeed of an aircraft. The next term we learned was altimeter. An altimeter is an instrument which displays the altitude of an aircraft above sea level. It relies on the pressure difference between different altitudes. That is, as you go higher, the atmospheric pressure decreases. And this pressure is measured by an aneroid barometer. The next instrument we learned about was artificial horizon. The artificial horizon displays the altitude of the aircraft relative to the horizon. and through this the pilot can understand if there is any pitch or if there is any roll to the aircraft. It uses a gyroscope to measure this information. The next instrument was VSI, or vertical speed indicator, which measures the rate of change in altitude, that is ascent or descent, of an aircraft by measuring the rate of change of pressure or the difference in pressure in two chambers which are present in the VSI. We also learnt about turn indicator and slip indicator. So turn indicator shows the rate of turn of an aircraft. It relies on the gyroscopic principle, but in this case the gyroscope is allowed to move only roll axis, and it relies on the gyroscopic precession on the gyroscope to show a rate of change of turn. The next was slip indicator, which measures the banking or the slipping of an aircraft. In this case, the gravitational centrifugal forces acting on a ball will show the pilot if the aircraft has a bank or a slip. The next topic we spoke about was radar. Radar stands for radio detection and ranging. Basically, electromagnetic waves or radar waves are used to detect and range an object, or to find the distance of an object. It consists of three parts, that is the transmitter, the antenna and the receiver. The transmitter will emit a radar wave, and this radio wave, is directed to an object by an antenna. And upon contact with the object, a certain amount of radio waves are bounced back, which is received by the receiver. We spoke about three types of radar, that is primary, secondary and continuous wave radar. In case of primary radar, a single pulse of radar is released, which hits all the objects in the atmosphere around it. When it hits these objects, a certain amount of the radio waves bounces back, and this time delay between the emission of the radio waves as well as reception of the radio waves can be used to estimate the distance to an object. The next was secondary waves, in which case multiple sets of radio waves are released to a particular object, and in case the object receives and identifies these radio waves, it will send a reply again in the form of radio waves. So as you can see, the cooperation of this object is needed. This is used in IFF systems in military application. Next, we spoke about continuous wave radar or CW radar, where a continuous set of radio waves are released without any ending, and this uses the Doppler effect to estimate the rate of change of position or to estimate the velocity of an object. So that was the end of this chapter. Thank you and Jai Hind.